are mightier, that you are greater, that you are stronger than anything the enemy has for us. God, you are doing a new thing in and through this church body and anyone who's watching. God, we pray for favor and for blessing in this season. But God, most importantly, that we know it's not about our way, but yours. You have the eyes of God. May we have the eyes that you have to see your vision for us. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop.
You never stop working.
Oh,
by the Lamb who was slain, I'm forgiven. The sinner's Savior, crown him forever. For the Lamb who was slain, he is risen.
My name is Jen Kennerly, and I am the Director of Children's Ministries here at Sugarloaf. On behalf of my pastor, Dr. Stephen Essery, and our whole team, it's my privilege to welcome you to worship. In just a few moments, we will continue to move our worship service forward. But until then, I get to share with you some of the exciting things that are launching this fall. We can literally feel fall in the air. Fall at Sugarloaf means that there are many opportunities for growth, for service, and for mission. Today, we're introducing a new way for you to stay connected and in the know about all things Sugarloaf by using a QR code. iPhone users will simply open your camera and point. Android users will need to download a QR reader app from the App Store if you haven't done so already. Let's try it together now. I invite you to get out your device, open your camera or QR code reader, and point it at the screen. There are a few important things to know. Student ministry is reopening on Wednesday, September 30th. Children's ministry is reopening on Sunday, October 18th. And look at this. This is where you'll find Pastor Stephen's message notes, so you can follow along during the service. These insightful notes will also be available weekly in advance for anyone who would want to print them and bring them to worship. These notes are located on the watch page of our website at www.sugarloaf.org/watch. There are lots of other exciting things on this page that we want you to know, so I encourage you to take a moment and get informed. This QR code will become a mainstay of connectivity each week for us in worship. This is the moment in our service where we pause to worship the Lord through our giving. Your generosity enables us to continue to be who God's called us to be in this county, in this community, and in all the world. We invite you to give to God's work and His kingdom through the ministry of Sugarloaf now. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we worship you, we praise you, and we thank you today that we can reopen our doors and be the bridge builders that you have called us to be to this community and to the world. Lord, all that we have, it comes from you. You are the giver of every good gift. You are the one who supplies every need that we have. So we freely give now in this moment to continue to have kingdom work through the ministry of Sugarloaf. everything we have is yours. Lord, bless this giving, multiply it, so that we can do all that you have called us to do. We ask that you bless it now and bless our time together. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's continue to worship together now.
Oh,
I'm always excited to start a new series and turn to a new place in the Bible to study the scriptures. Today we're starting a new series called Short Stories, and we're going to study just some of the most incredible stories that Jesus told. You know, Jesus was a master storyteller. And whenever Jesus told stories, he was always pointing to the kingdom life. During this series, I'm going to have the opportunity to share with you six what I believe are just incredible stories that just blow your mind and get you to thinking and really have a chance to impact the heart. But one of the things I love about the stories of Jesus are that when he tells a story, you just don't know where it's going. He often has a twist or a turn that has an incredible impact. But one of the more powerful things is his stories leave the listeners just thinking. I mean, you have a chance to, in your imagination, understand or conjecture where this story went, how it was going to go, what were the reasons this happened or that happened. And so today we're going to begin with what many consider to be the most famous story of Jesus. It's a story about a good Samaritan. Now, what's interesting about that term, good Samaritan, is it's even become a modern day description of somebody who is nice to somebody else and helps them in a time of need. But this story, which is just so short, it's just a few scriptures long, this story just became a story that took on a life of its own. As a matter of fact, today there are orphanages and homes that are called Samaritan places. They're using that name, that Good Samaritan. There are hospitals that are called the Good Samaritan hospitals. There are even laws today, governmental laws, Good Samaritan laws, that encourage people to stop along the way and to help somebody else who is in a time of need. So we're going to read this story. It's found in Luke chapter 10. And I believe one of the best ways to read the stories of Jesus is just to kind of sit back and pretend you're one of the people in the crowd. You're just listening in. You're listening to a master storyteller, and you're thinking through what he's trying to convey. So Jesus was teaching. There were lots of people there, and a lawyer spoke up. A lawyer was going to test Jesus. So I'm not going to interrupt Jesus' story. I'm just going to read it together, and we're going to listen in on a master storyteller telling a story about the kingdom. In Luke chapter 10, in verse 25, it says this. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What is written in the law? He replied. How do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this and you will live. But he wanted to justify himself. So he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and they went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite. When he came to the place, he saw him, he passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and he bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And then he put the man on his own donkey and he took him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day, he took out 2 silver coins and he gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. when I listen into a story like that, it feels like I'm there in that moment watching this interaction between Jesus and an expert in the law. For just a few minutes, let me share a few thoughts about this story and what Jesus is trying to convey in the story. But before we even get to the story, let's just notice the environment. There's an expert in the law. Now, I guess you could think of that person as a lawyer, but I think if you thought of him as a lawyer in modern day terms, you might miss the point. He was an expert in the law, the Mosaic law, which means he knew the front of the book really well. He knew the Old Testament. He knew the Mosaic law backwards and forwards. He knew a lot. He's a very religious person. And he comes to Jesus and he wants to test him. Now, I don't know if that's a very smart thing to test Jesus, but Jesus isn't. He's not flustered by this guy testing him. He receives his question. And the guy asks him a question. Basically, he says, how can I get to heaven? How can I inherit eternal life? And Jesus answers the question with a question. He says, well, what does the law tell you? How do you read the law? And what's so important in this moment, you've got to get it. Before the story even unfolds, there's a picture of the kingdom, of how to live in eternity with the Father forever. The lawyer says, love the Lord your God with your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. You know, for us sugar loafers, we actually wear those two things on bracelets all the time. Love God, love people. That's the big two. Love God, love people. And that's what the lawyer says in that moment. Love the Lord your God with your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus answers him, you've got it. Go and do that, and you're going to live. If you love God, you love people, you will live. And then the lawyer, wanting to justify himself, asked that big next question, but who is my neighbor? Which people do I really have to love? Which people do I really have to care for? And it's in that moment that Jesus tells the story of the kingdom, this short story that gives us a picture of heaven. So there was a man going down a road from Jerusalem to Jericho. By the way, that's called the Jericho Road. It goes from Jerusalem, which is very high up in the mountains, down to the Dead Sea area, one of the lowest places on planet Earth. There's a road that journeys that way. It's called today the Jericho Road, but even in their day, it was called the Bloody Road because it was a steep road, a lot of rocks, caves, cliffs. It was a very easy place for bandits and robbers to hide out. This guy in Jesus' story gets attacked. He's stripped of his clothes. He's beaten. And you remember what Jesus said in his story. He is left half dead. And then Jesus says a couple of people come along to have a chance to help their neighbor. The first one's a priest. Now, in this modern understanding of Jesus' story, we would call that a pastor or a clergy person. This is the professional person who is in charge of the temple. This is one of the leaders of Judaism. This is a priest. And the priest sees the guy wounded. He crosses over, passes by him on the other side, and goes on his way. The next person in Jesus' story is a Levite. A Levite would have been, in modern day terms, kind of like a very godly lay person, an elder in the church, so to speak. The Levites were lay people in charge of the affairs of the temple. And so the Levite does the exact same thing. He sees the guy who is wounded. He crosses the street, passes by on the other side, and goes on his way. Now, these were religious people. But oftentimes in Jesus' stories, it's the religious people who are not quite meeting up to the mark. And so it's the religious person who doesn't help their neighbor in Jesus' story. But in most of Jesus' short stories, he has a flip. He has a little twist. He has something that you're not really expecting, something that makes your mind just pause for a moment and say, wait a minute. And that's exactly what happens next. In Jesus' words, in his story, he said, but a Samaritan as he traveled came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. That phrase, took pity on him, as literally he had compassion. His heart went out to him. And his heart responded in that moment is the Samaritan that goes to help this guy who is wounded. Now, it occurred to me this week that a lot of people who know that phrase, Good Samaritan, they probably don't even know what a Samaritan is. You know, a Samaritan was a person who got that name because they were a part of the Jewish nationality who were enslaved in Babylonia, and they were part of the first remnant that were freed and allowed to come back to Israel. There were three different remnants, groups of people that traveled back in exile from that captivity in Babylonia across many, many years. But one of the first groups, when they came back, instead of them starting the nation back and starting their religion back and getting back into their homeland, instead of them doing all the things that would have been right according to God's law, they actually began to do things that were wrong, and they began to intermarry with other races. And so literally in that culture, Jesus is telling this story. When you talked about a Samaritan, Jews called them half-breeds. These were people who had defiled their true religion of Yahweh. These were people who had intermarried with other races. These were people who had betrayed them both nationally and spiritually. There was an open hostility between Jews and Samaritans. Best way to say it, they hated them. Jews hated Samaritans. And in Jesus' story, it's the Samaritan who's the hero. Now let's pause for just a minute and let's go back. I think you've got to ask yourself, why didn't the priest or the Levite stop to help the guy? You know, in my mind, I came up with a few thoughts even as I was thinking about this story. Maybe it was because they were religious. I mean, maybe they were going up to worship at the temple, and by stopping here, they were helping a Samaritan, they would become unclean. And so they didn't want to have to cleanse themselves or not be able to worship for a few days at the temple. So that's not something they wanted to do. They were on a mission to go and worship. And their religion kept them, maybe, from helping, which is a sad state of affairs. As a matter of fact, I often tell people, I'm not necessarily religious. I'm not about religion. I'm about relationship. And so religion sometimes can actually keep us from being the people God wants us to be. Maybe it was because they were being very religious. By the way, sometimes I think we need to ask ourselves, how religious are we? And does that stuff actually get in our way? And is it baggage? Another reason maybe they passed by on the other side was maybe it was the state of their heart. Maybe they just weren't compassionate. Maybe they saw him wounded and their heart just didn't go out to him the way that the Samaritan's heart did. And I think that begs the question, how compassionate are you? How compassionate am I? Is my heart, if I saw somebody in need, would my heart go out to them? Not my head, my heart. Would I feel their pain, feel their wound? Would I be with them in that moment? Maybe another very honest reason they passed by on the other side was they were prejudiced. I mean, we said a minute ago that Jews hated Samaritans, and they would have been able to tell this is a person who is different than them. This is a foreigner whom they hated. Maybe they had bias and prejudice in their heart. Maybe they said, not that person. I'm not helping them. That's a shame if that's the case, but maybe that's the reason they did that. But there's another reason in my mind. Maybe it was just an inconvenient thing. Maybe that would have meant stopping and taking some time out. Maybe they were busy. Maybe they were hurried. Inconvenience might have kept them. You know, one of the most wonderful things about Jesus' story is I bet you have your own reasons. This is where the Jesus' story gets the imagination going of the listener. Why didn't they stop? And I bet you could come up with 1,000 reasons in your mind about why they didn't stop and they kept going. But the Samaritan, let's go to the hero of the story, right? The Samaritan. What did the Samaritan do? The Samaritan, first and foremost, stopped. The Samaritan stopped what he was doing, and he saw the guy where he was, and his heart went out to him. And the Bible literally says he went to him, which means he went to where he was, but he knelt down where he was. He got with him in his pain and in his wound, and he began to minister to him, to heal him. The Bible says he literally picked him up and put him on his donkey. He begins to pick him up from that place and travel him to another place so he can get well, to take him to somebody else who can actually help him. And you know the rest of the story. He takes him to an inn. He provides for him. He bandages up his wounds. He even gives enough money for that guy to stay in the inn for 2 months, 2 denarii, 2 silver coins. He could stay there for 2 months, just make sure this guy gets well. He provides for him. Now, one of the things that I think is the most important thing is Jesus is speaking to a Jewish crowd. And in Jesus's story, it's the person that they hate the most, probably, that Jesus is saying, hey, listen, you want to be a neighbor? You have compassion, you have mercy, and you take action. Basically, what he was saying in that moment was, he was saying, be like the Samaritan. Jesus is giving us a picture of the kingdom. You know, as I close this message, I just want to close with 2 simple thoughts for you. And the first one is this. Let's go back to the beginning before the story ever took place. The lawyer asks a question. He says, how can I get to heaven? How can I inherit eternal life? And the answer to the question is right there. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. You know, there's a lot of places in the Bible when we think about descriptions of how we can live forever in heaven and be reunited with the Father. We learn that salvation through faith, and we think about good works and righteousness. But you know, in this place, let's just sit in the story for a minute. Jesus doesn't talk about faith. Jesus doesn't talk about going to church. Jesus doesn't talk about being religious. You know what the answer to the question is? You want to inherit eternal life? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. In Jesus' words to that lawyer that day, and you will live. Wow, hold on to that this week as you live, and may you love God and love people well. But the second thing I want to share with you is actually right at the end of the story. Jesus says, go and do likewise. Who was the one of the three that was the neighbor to the wounded man? The one who had mercy on him. Go and do likewise. I was 24 years old, and in my first semester at Emory University, attending seminary, when I took a preaching course. And as God's will would have it, the very first text that I was ever assigned to preach on in seminary was Luke chapter 10. The story, the short story of the Good Samaritan. I remember studying it backwards and forward, exegeting the text, and I was so nervous that day to stand up as a 24-year-old in front of all the professors and all the different students, many of them even lawyers from the school next door, and to preach that message. And I remember that one of the most important things that I drove towards at the very end was that singular question that I think just sits with a listener. Which one of the three are you? Would you be, if you saw somebody wounded today, would you be like the priest? Would you be like the Levite? Or would you be like the Samaritan? And that day I closed the message by saying, which one of those three are you? But can I tell you, this many years later, when I read this text, I read it a totally different way. Jesus closed the message. Grab this. Jesus closed his story by saying, which one of those three was a neighbor to the wounded man? Jesus didn't ask the question to the lawyer, hey, which one of those three are you like? That's not his question. He said, which one of those three was the neighbor to the man who had been beaten and robbed and wounded? The lawyer said, it was the one who had mercy on him. Jesus said, go, you do likewise. You see, this is the power of the gospel to me. You know, this many years later, I think the way I look at the scripture now is totally different. It doesn't really matter which of those three you were when you started listening to this story. It doesn't matter whether you would have been the priest, the Levite, or the Samaritan. The question is, after hearing Jesus' story and understanding what it's like to be a person of mercy and compassion who would love your neighbor as yourself, which one is the neighbor? It's the one who shows mercy. You go and do likewise. The beauty of the gospel is this week, church, we have a chance to go out and be the Good Samaritan, to lay down our life for others, to stop, to see with compassion, to meet in their moment of need, to raise them up, and to move them towards life. My prayer for you and for me, in the awesome name of the greatest teacher who ever walked this planet, is that we would go and do likewise. Would you pray with me? Oh God, thank you for the stories that you told that helped life, resurrection life, happen in our lives. God, forgive us for those moments when we seek ourselves. God, forgive us for those moments when we let prejudice and inconvenience or maybe even religion stop us from being the people you want us to be. And God, we hear the good news of the gospel today, that if we want to inherit eternal life, love the Lord your God with your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus, this is our clarion call. We want to listen to your story and be transformed by it. So this week, we pray that you would give us hearts filled with compassion. You'd give us eyes able to see. And God, you would help us go and be the neighbor to those around us, to love them as ourselves. In so doing, may eternal life reside in us. And may we inherit that eternal life found in you, Jesus. We love you and we pray all this in your most holy name. Amen. I pray this week that in many different ways, you would find places, moments, and ways to love the Lord your God with your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And I know this, just by you hearing this message today, God's gonna put people of need out there in front of you. I pray you would have eyes to see and a heart to respond. And I pray that Jesus would be pleased as you seek to love your neighbor as yourself. Hey, would you share this benediction with me this morning? Let's pray together this. And now, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. God bless you, Sugarloaf. Have a great week.